And welcome back. Last episode in Elmshore, we found Verona, and completed the second stage of Berath's quest. Killed her, and killed the guy in here at Arch something or other. Anyway, so now we can go back into Tir Eivron and get the goods. Well, we're not going to get any goods. We're going to speak to Berath, which will undoubtedly be rather awesome. The same way as if we spoke to the other two gods. Pretty epic stuff. Alright, hopefully I'm not getting allergies here. I mean, there's a lot of pollen in the Twin Elms area. Anyway, so, yes, Berath. Oh, right, right. What does Berath represent? If we don't say the right phrase, we get things attacking us, which, you know, is okay. We'll kill them. But still, I like to try to get it right. God of death, cycles, doorways, mortality, and inevitability. The keeper of the cycle of life and death. Oh, we've said this before, actually. I think this is it. Oh, we don't have to say it. Okay. As you pray to Berath, you again find yourself on the road. Squinting into the distance, you see a short, pale figure waiting for you. At first, you think it's another vision of Archdruid Restin. That's the one we killed in Blood Sands. But then you notice the figure's skeletal frame and a rictus grin. He stands in front of another skull gate, but the way leads down, not onward. He beckons for you to approach. Kanna says, "The Usher, gatekeeper at the Shroud. Not here for us, I hope. I'm not done just yet." Behind you is a woman, her skin milk pale against her black hair. She wears a suit of armor so dark it seems to suck the light from the stars. The road winds up a mountain behind her.
"A tall traveler."
That's Berath. She holds out a hand. Aloth says, "And the pallid knight." "As usual, I pick the female. Pay the pallid knight." You drop a few coppers into her hand, and she closes her fist around the coins. You instantly feel a small weight added to your purse. Well, we've gave copper, and we have a weight added to our purse? "The lord of this road demands a toll of all, but he lends generously, that all might travel his road again." Behind her, the usher grins his lipless smile and waits. The road bores into the mountains, and you find yourself in a gigantic cavern. The ceiling curves up and away, and it's dotted with moisture. At this distance, the shining beads look like stars, clustered and scattered in constellations. The usher and the pallid knight lead you up a trail carved into the edge of the cavern. Two identical cave mouths wait up ahead, and you follow the usher to one of them. Standing at the edge and gazing down, you see an endless, ever-changing plain bisected by a road. Only then do you realize that you're no longer on the road. As you follow the road to a point where it disappears below you, you realize that you're standing in one of the eye sockets of a massive skull. The usher points to the road. Archdruid Restin appears below you. He's just as you remembered him, stern and smooth-skinned. Yet with each step along the road, he grows, swelling with blood and essence. His heavy steps become slower and slower until he stops altogether. His distended body fills the path completely.
"You met a dwarf traveling this road. What did you do?"
The pallid knight's voice is low and soft. Well, they're all correct answers, I think, more or less. Reston had stood in place for too long. I merely set him moving again. The pallid knight's flesh is taut against her skull. She nods once, barely dipping her chin.
Life is kinetic. Forward motion. 100 beginnings and endings nested within a million more.
Indeed. As Reston's swollen body ruptures, the effect is like a dam bursting. Ghostly figures, as hazy and indistinct as wisps of smoke, continue along the cleared path. Some tumble and rush along, while others amble and drift, but all continue forward. The usher directs your attention to another figure moving down the path. Whatever her name is, the woman we found in Elmshore. Right, Arona. This time you see high ovate Arona. As she follows the road, her movements become slow and erratic. Her legs creak with each step, and her feet grow long, thick roots that burrow into the ground. She finally stops, rooted in place.
You found a tree that had lived for centuries. Its roots were deep, and its boughs sheltered many. Why did you cut it down?
I enjoy cutting things down. Number 4, is that true? It was a parasite. While its branches sheltered others, its roots sucked them dry.
All draw their life's energy from the deaths of others. This is why all must remain part of the cycle of death and rebirth. No creature may be a closed loop unto itself.
Arona's body petrifies below, and the shimmering leaves of her hair blow down the path. You seek another who has lived his lives on the brink of the cycle. He sits on the inside of the wheel, observing its revolutions. With each life, he is plucked from the stream and returned to it intact. Why do you hunt Theos? Entrap thousands of souls for Whitaker. I've got to stop him from giving her absolute power. For answers, understands what's happened to me, revenge, or resolution. Put an end to the pain he's caused me. We've told other gods something different, but we'll tell this one that Theos has entrapped thousands of souls for Whitaker. I've got to stop him from giving her absolute power.
If you know this much, then another god has already spoken with you and given you half of the answer.
Two gods, actually. Theos serves Whitaker. She desires an escape from her own cycle. Power without decline. Theos has remained thousands of souls from the cycle so that their essence might empower her. The black depths of her eyes threaten to swallow you. You must stop him, and you must return them to the cycle. Okay, well, if that's more than half the answer, we already know it. Why does Whitaker even need Theos' help? And why do you need mine, for that matter? The gods guide souls through the cycle of death and rebirth, but Eora is the domain of mortals. We stand aside, weights and counterweights. Were one to alter the tides of Kith, all would follow. We would tip this world from its axis. That is why Whitaker directs a mortal to do her bidding, and why any who would stop Theos must be mortal as well. What end would it serve to send the souls back into the cycle? Attending to these souls is a question of stability, Watcher. Of maintaining the natural order of the world and the ebb and flow of essence. Number 1 is a very good idea. Excuse me again. Freaking throat noises. Cycles are changeless. Couldn't they be returned to Hollowborn? As battered, burdened things, do you mix soured rind with fresh? The kindness you seek in giving them a new beginning. Oh, lies in giving them a new beginning, not in shackling them to this life. What's wrong with Whitaker seizing this power? The cycle of Kith is a thing of balance. Likewise is the cycle of gods. We rise and fall in favor of the mortals, only to fall and rise again. But Whitaker seeks the power to place herself outside this cycle. She would root herself and grow to the detriment of others. The usher silently gestures to the road, where a broken tree and a husk of flesh are still visible. If Theos has meddled with these souls, perhaps it would be better to destroy them. The cycle is merciless, but it is not wasteful. Time and endless procession of rebirths eventually grind into dust, but even then they must pass from the world and return to it. Their continuing movement advances the cycle itself. The god might be pissed at this, but cycles are changeless and monotonous. Surely there's a better alternative. The illusion of revolution? It is merely part of another cycle, and a painful one. True change has structure, geometry. It is the product of cycles within cycles, a thousand gears spinning and moving the universe by degrees. I think I understand what you're telling me. It's the only thing we would say. The usher gestures to the road and the starry expanse beyond while the pallid knight speaks. I only show you the motion of the universe, Watcher. I don't see what this has to do with me. Theos builds a dam to divert water from a stream. The flow of thousands of souls will shape the world you live in, Watcher. It will also shape the world your soul returns to in its next lives. I must go to Sun and Shadow now.
No mortal can survive the descent into the pit. But there are souls on the burial isle that are pledged to me. I will grant them to you. And they shall bear you down safely, as well as light the way beyond.
A multitude appears at the other end of the road, raising their voices and kicking up dust as they make their way toward you. What's that? Return them to the cycle, Watcher. Promise that you will, and I shall give power befitting a champion of death. The pallid knight raises a finger. Accept my favor, however, and I will demand this decision as your due. I collect all from all mortals in time. I would hear what the other gods have to say first. Do not delay long, Watcher. What Theos seeks to do cannot be undone, even by the turning of the wheel. The usher points behind you. When you turn, you find yourself again standing in Tir Evron. Well, that seemed to be the least epic one. Only one god. Excuse me. Berath tires of mortals evading the natural cycle of death and rebirth. He showed me two individuals in particular, a dwarven man and an elven woman, who have extended their lives for centuries. Berath is pleased that both druid leaders have returned to the cycle. The goddess promised me safe passage to Sun and Shadow and support in my pursuit of Theos. Taxes collected. Grand adventure. Grieving mother. Okay, well, when we talked to Remergand, we had Andra and Skane. Talked to Berath. This is Whitaker's constellation. So Whitaker's not gonna come with. And this is Helia. Oh, so we just go talk to Helia herself then. Because these three were the first ones we talked to. Alright, this is Whitaker. Whale. Why won't Whale speak? I mean, we know Whitaker. We're fighting against Whitaker. God of secrets, revelations, illusions, cryptography, obfuscation, perception, dreams, and visions. Whale is a mystery with no consistent form or gender. Its followers revel in the acts of creating and unraveling mysteries. Okay. So Whale is a mystery. And is going to remain a mystery, apparently. Alright, so that's that. So next time we'll be back here when we finish Helia's quest. This is going to take a while. Because it's up at the top. Where her sanctuary is. And we have to fight a dragon. Temple of Helia. So we have to pass through Northweald first and explore that whole area. And then head to Temple of Helia. Now, I remember where this bird is. In one of the homes, actually. I was thinking at first in the inn in Hearthsong, but it's one of those homes in Hearthsong. The lady had a bird. And, don't we have that? Don't we have that cage? No, the cage had a beetle in it. I think that was somebody else. Alright, never mind. Alright, so what else do we have to do? Other than the main quest. That's Helia's. Oh, this we need to go to, the Northweald. Northweald. Return to Radric's Hold. We're not doing that yet. We got other bigger fish to fry. Find a druid who knows more about the Autumn Stelgear. Oh, Haravius? We have to go get him back. Grieving Mother. Oh, that we're not doing because we have to kill that guy, and I'm not doing that. There's no reason for us to kill him because he took someone else's artifact, and, you know, it might be hers, it might be his, but we're just going to kill him just because she says, and no, it's just, that's weak. On the shores of Bale Lake. Okay, Sagani, yeah, so come with us. And these are the dungeon underneath Cadnua, the endless paths of Adnua. Alright, the songbirds. Oh, Telalari, you dealt with Renato. Okay, that's also in Hearthsong. I thought we wrapped that up. Still have to tell her, okay. Adnua. Oh, Grimda, yeah, she wants to kill us, so we can't finish that one. We're not buying him knives, and it's more of the endless paths of Adnua. Okay. Off to Hearthsong. Wrap up two quests, and then we'll head to the Northweald after that. Well, we're gonna wrap up one quest and further another. I mean, if I am right, that's the bird I'm thinking of is the one we want. Could be a coincidence. Alright, well, let's go up here. I think the home with what's her name in it is here. Adam Fath or not, his spirit hungers for power in his old age. Why would Simak foster the Elamfath child from another tribe, then? Fear of death curdles not only blood, but the spirit. Ah. Alarhi. You are welcome into our hearth. What news do you bring? Renato won't trouble you anymore. He's dead. Dead? Alarhi's eyebrow raises. Her posture stiffens. I am not surprised given his behavior thus far, but the death of a Valian merchant could bode poorly for trade. Reaching into her robes, Alarhi produces a small pouch. Still, the matter is settled, and Renato will no longer darken our market. Here is your payment for services rendered. Travel safely, Estremor. Okay, so you guys can read about this really quick if you want to pause it. We encountered him in the beginning when we first came to Twin Elms in the Hearthsong District, which was the first one we explored, naturally. Thank you, Estremor. You have my gratitude. Tusk Stelgar will find a way to continue without Simak. Okay. Just looking. Okay. I guess we'll try in here. Just don't remember which home it is.
Hail, Estremor.
Huh. Well, it's her. We meet again, Estremor. What is it you require? Delem sent me to collect rare songbirds. She stares at you blankly for a moment before shaking her head. That fop Delem sent you? No, absolutely not. Eating my beloved pet won't grant that fool musical prowess. The only thing he'll get is an upset stomach and the pain of passing a beak. She folds her arm and frowns. There's a forest full of birds. Mine's not for sale. Alright, so I agree killing your bird seems unnecessary. We'll look elsewhere. That ends that. Why would Delem believe that eating birds will help or intellect? Yeah, I'm heading towards 3. Let's just say, why would Delem believe that eating birds will help? Because I'm really curious as to the answer. Old folklore gone awry, she mutters, shrugging in resignation. Orlans, particularly those raised in the forest, still seem to believe that, by eating noteworthy creatures, they can gain the desirable traits of their prey. It's false. Eating a spider doesn't give you 8 legs any more than eating ivy lets you sprout berries. If Delem wants to be a better singer, he should try practice, not superstition. Animals aren't ours to cage. I don't think you or Delem should have it. The bird should be free. Well, she stares at you blankly. It's not like the bird is a prisoner. I mean, he has a little bit of room to fly in here. You just want me to set Beaker free so you can snatch him and sell him to Delem. If I wanted the bird that badly, you'd be counting your teeth already. Well, should I lie or threaten it? Neither is particularly pleasant. Plus, it doesn't say lie, so me actually choosing one might cause that to become what I do. If I wanted the bird that badly, you'd be counting your teeth already. Her face blanches with surprise. You can't talk to me like that. Get out. Get out of my house right now. in my house at once. There's the bird.
A simple test.
Oh, don't unlock that. I don't want to bring everyone down on our heads like that.
My eyes are peeled.
What?
Is he gonna attack him? And then everyone's gonna attack? It doesn't say stealing. TM Songbird. The red crest of this songbird adorns an otherwise plain plumage of brown and black feathers. The bird seems used to being handled and often begins to sing when left alone for a while. Take? Leave my house at once. She just let us take it. Okay, that works. I found a TM songbird inside a home in the Hearthsong district. Okay, I'm pretty sure the other one's at the top of Helios Temple, and we're gonna head there anyway, so... Some of us are sneaking. Song. All right. This district was once one of the liveliest. Their hands set their own city afire, and they call us uncivilized. We're talking about, Defiance Bay. She just had that to say, and now she walks away.
You must gather your party before venturing forth.
Who's lagging be?
Hey. Hey.
A dare.
Eh?
So funny hearing that. I think that's only the second time I've actually
time
heard
to
it.
See and not be seen.
Northwield, here we come. I've arrived to the Northwield Wilderness, where Quinnith's expedition should be making camp beside the pilgrim trail leading to Helios Temple. I am to warn them that Glamfellen scouts are on their trail. The fangs, right? I've arrived to the Northwield, is where Fjorm and Arthen have journeyed to hunt a fabled giant Stelgar, and where I may find clues to the events that transpired during their hunt. I've arrived at the Northwield, a forest outside of Twin Elms. The steps leading up to the nest are carved in the steep cliffs that border the northern edge of this wilderness. Is that it? So, tune back next time when we explore the Northwield and take care of a couple quests. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.